In a little over a month, Indonesia will head to the polls, and soon we'll be bringing you profiles of the two main contenders for the top job. But tonight we focus on Australia's relationship with our giant neighbour, one that's seen plenty of ups and downs over the years. As Mark Davis reports, there's been more down than up in the past 12 months, including the contentious policy of turning back the boats. In Jakarta, Mark sat down with Foreign Minister Marty Natalegawa, and he says Australia is keeping Indonesia in the dark over its sovereign borders activities.
There are more spy claims involving Australia and Indonesia tonight.
Violence has broken out at a protest outside the Australian embassy in Jakarta.
The past year has been a tough one on the Australian-Indonesian relationship. Last year's election campaign set the tone, with Indonesia often being placed centre stage in a key election issue.
Indonesia is the transit point for the vast majority of the people who come illegally by boat to this country.
When Tony Abbott gained office, he promised he'd be open and upfront with Indonesia about any policy changes that affected them.
We will take a respectful, consultative, no surprises approach to relations with Indonesia.
But then came the spying scandal, with revelations that Australia had been bugging not only the president's phone, but also the phone of his wife and a string of senior Indonesian officials. To add salt to the wound, it was exactly in this period that Australia's policy of forcibly returning refugee boats to Indonesian waters entered its most active stage.
We absolutely, totally respect Indonesia's sovereignty.
But it seems the Australian Navy didn't get that memo and repeatedly entered Indonesian waters without authority.
We are risking a slippery slope.
From spies to prowling warships, they're all problems that have landed on the desk of Indonesia's Foreign Minister, Marty Natalegawa.
No, not really.
It's been a tough job, but he's handled it with his customary discretion. With an election looming and his term likely coming to an end, I ask Natalegawa to reflect on the current state of the relationship with Australia.
Thanks for joining us, sir. There's been some icy times between Australia and Indonesia in the last 12 months. How would you rate it today on a scale of 1 to 10?
I think we are now back on the upward trajectory. You are quite correct. We've had a somewhat difficult time recently, but both governments are working earnestly and with a great deal of urgency to try to get the relationship to back where it was before.
What do you see as the ongoing points of tension then? What are the areas of concern?
Well, there's been two issues that's somewhat related in the end. The surveillance issue is one, but the other one is the issue of how one manage the issue of people smuggling or asylum seekers.
Well, that's likely to be an ongoing issue, even if the other is resolved. During the election, the Australian election last year, there was a lot of bluster being spoken in that election about how tough Australia should be with Indonesia over these boats. How was that received within political circles in Jakarta? I know you handled it very diplomatically, but what was the mood?
Well, it hasn't been helpful, obviously. That's why we are very keen, together with Australia, to get back to where we've been.
Because there's certainly been an undertone of aggression. I mean, not necessarily from Tony Abbott, but in that election campaign, there was an element of aggression there. I'm interested in how you were reading that from here.
Yeah, I mean, we are trying to understand and remind ourselves that there is a political context that was then happening. So far, it's been very testing situation, because we are seeing a policy that is often very difficult for us to be giving the impression of working hand in hand in unity. Yeah.
Well, Tony Abbott did say last year, or when he won, he said there'd be no surprises for Indonesia in his policies. Has that borne out to be correct?
There has been some issues that we had not anticipated before, but some, to be fair, is not of the current government's making. After all, the issue of surveillance is not something that just happened overnight. But it has a long, apparently a long established practice. but the issue of people smuggling as well, asylum seekers. So now it's been, you know, we were often, you know, somewhat caught by surprise, to be honest.
Has Indonesia been informed when Australia sends back refugee boats? Do they advise you? No, is that a surprise?
Yes, of course. Yeah, I mean, we often, it often comes to our notice when such a policy takes place after event, and so this is certainly not something that we really appreciate. It's very important to have a great deal of communications.
But give me an idea of what happens. I mean, when you hear news of that Australian warships, naval vessels, have entered Indonesian waters, so do you pick up the phone and call?
Yes, of course.
Because we
want to ensure that there is no miscommunication and misunderstanding, and that the issue doesn't get out of hand. And that's why, even at a situation, difficult situation, it's even more important for communications and hotlines of communication to be established.
The most recent event was some refugee boats being turned back into Indonesian waters, but there's been reports that there were additional passengers put on board. Have you sought confirmation of from Australia?
I personally have not heard about this so-called two extra passengers, persons, Albanians, whether they were from the other ship that had sunk, or was it? Did they come from elsewhere? I'm yet to be informed. But the important point is what I had said from the very beginning. This is like a slippery slope, in terms of how far do you facilitate or return the boats in terms of policy.
What's your general view of Australia's offshore asylum seeker policy?
We are trying to understand how one reconciles such a policy with Australia's own national commitments, international commitments. But that's really for Australians to judge how, to what extent such policy actually is consistent with Australia's commitment and international commitments. But having offshore facilities in places like Papua New Guinea or Nauru, and now even Cambodia, supposedly, I'm not sure what kind of signal that is actually sending in terms of burden sharing.
Has Australia asked Indonesia to establish such camps?
Not recently, no. We know we do what we can and what we must, but we hope Australia also as well shoulder more of the responsibility.
The president is known as a diplomatic and calm man. I know you can't predict the outcome of any Indonesian elections, but are there others within the Indonesian political spectrum who are unlikely to be as facilitating as SBY has to Australia?
Well, we'll see when the time comes. But as a foreign minister, I am keen to ensure that when the baton is passed from this government to the next, it will be passed in a where the Indonesia-Australia relations is already back on track. We must ensure that the situation gets managed quickly. Yeah.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Indonesia's foreign minister there with Mark Davis. Go to our website for a timeline of the recent diplomatic tensions between Australia and Indonesia. Plus, let us know your reaction to Marty Natalegawa's comments at sbs.com.au/dateline.